is Tara.
And I'm Cesar.
And we're making a presentation based on a daily life in China, but this city, so chapter one, so that's what we're starting with. And the first couple important notes that we found is, one, the city life in China is very different from the rural life in China. I feel like we've spent so much time in our lectures discussing the rural life, so it was very interesting to read this chapter and just find a lot of different notes about this. The book actually categorized it into five different sections: the choice of Hangzhou as capital, the overpopulation and the scarcity of amenities, fires and firefighting, communications and supplies, and then the amenities of urban life. And Hangzhou is actually the romanized name for the city, and in more common culture you'll actually hear it as Hangzhou, which is, they're still said the same way, but that's the more legitimate translation. And just for the purpose of the slides and for this presentation, we're going to stay with the first romanized name just because that's what you guys read in your text as well.
Yeah. Alrighty, so the key thing here is the choice of Hangzhou as a capital. One of the big reasons why they chose it was because they were actually getting, I think it's the Song Dynasty was getting chased out of the north by the Mongols that were invading. And the reason why they like really chose this is because of its location. It was located along like a man-made lake type of thing on one side, a river on the other, and then mountains around the entire region. So it was very well protected. They were able to avoid all the Mongols coming in, and they were kind of limited to only entering the city from like two sides, so it made it easy to defend. One big thing that they had going for them was the whole economical aspect of it. At first, they didn't really want the city to be the capital, which is the next part of the dilemma, but once the courts took hold of the city, they like chose it, like, all right, well, we're going to be here, let's set up shop. Once that happened, the city started to boom, and it started to grow more and more, and eventually became one of the richest and most populous cities in all of like the world at the time. The other thing was that there was a dilemma. So when they did go to Hangzhou, they realized this is a good city to, like, that's safe. They only saw it as like a temporary solution. They were like, well, eventually we want to move back to our other capital. They still kind of saw like the previous capital as like their like real capital, and it wasn't until later on that they realized like this is a good place, we're actually going to use this as our capital. Yeah. This kind of shows like the location where it's at. As you can see, like, up here along the Yellow River Valley was where the previous capital was, and they eventually just kind of like kept going down along their trade routes and ended up over here in Hangzhou. This is a French depiction from 1914 of what this city looked like. As you can see, like, everything is kind of close together. There's canals running through the city. It's very vibrant and colorful, and there was actually a lot of like foreigners in the city too as well. They had their own little section where they were there for trade and all that other stuff. And this is what the city kind of looked like at the time.
Okay, so the next subtopic was the overpopulation and scarcity of accommodations. And in the beginning of the section, we learned that there is actually a census system that the city set up. And with that, we have some data from that. So from 1165 to 1173, over 100,000 families were there, making the population just below 500,000. Then the next bracket of time that we have is from 1241 to 1252, and that pretty much was 111,000 families. Put it above the 500,000 people mark, and then finally 1270 is one of the last points that we have, and that's 186,330 families, and that counted the population at over 900,000. So it kept on reaching up to that 1 million mark. And some of the quotes that we found is from a citizen in 1275 in Hangzhou, and he said that still today the population of the town continues to increase year by year and month by month. So people were having more children, people were living longer, so the population just kept on rising. And then also at Hangzhou, the buildings were close together, certainly more than several hundred thousand families and over a million persons. And at the time, this was compared not only because of the population and the overpopulation, but other aspects we're going to talk about later. It was compared to two Italian cities of Padua and Venice that are in the Veneto province of northern Italy. So that was pretty much the comparison that was made.
All right, so the next big thing to talk about were the fires that happened in the city. This is mostly, like, there's two statistics up there of the two big fires that really happened. One was in 1132, which burnt down 13,000 homes, and then there was the one in 1137, which burnt down 10,000 homes. After this was when they actually took in consideration that they were going to do something similar to what they had done in the previous capital. But the reason why these fires were so prominent was because there was As the book quotes, multi-story houses situated in mostly crowded districts, which were merely a network of alleyways built of bamboo and wood. So, as you can imagine, tons of homes close together, all made of wood and bamboo. They're very flammable. It's really easy for fire to grow and spread. And it was unlike the cities that they had before up in the north that were like spread out and like wide and had streets that were like really, really wide across. With, like, I think that the book said that they were 100 yards in some parts, and at the least they were 40 yards like wide for the streets. So it separated these districts and was able to allow them to, like, if a fire started in one, it wouldn't spread to the next one. Unlike here in Hangzhou, where the districts were so close together that if there was a fire, it would spread easily and just keep growing and growing and growing until eventually it ran out of stuff to burn. The way they fought these fires was they grew upon their old system, which was setting up these like guard towers and just like watchtowers to like watch over the entire city. And they said there was about a guard tower every 500 yards, and these watchtowers had soldiers that were permanently there all the time, like watching over. And the one thing that the city did that a lot of people didn't like was they put a restriction and like a curfew on when they could have like an actual fire in their home, just for like food and cooking purposes. This only really applied to like the smaller districts that were really compact that had a lot of families in them, but it didn't really apply to like the markets and everything that were a little more spread out. They were along one of the main routes. It's called the Imperial Way, which was there's like tea shops and everything along there. They were able to keep their own like fires and like lights and everything a little bit later on at night. They didn't affect the economy a small amount, only because merchants didn't want to leave their stuff in the city or like bring any goods over because they were worried that there's a chance there might be a fire and all of our stuff will be gone. And even after they had put in these like installations to fight the fires, there were still fires that continued to happen like the years and years after this, and the city just kept burning down and people would run to the mountains and eventually have to come back and rebuild their lives.
Yeah. And this dense population, the multi-story homes, is one of the issues that they had trying to get a census, because it was hard with all the fires and being burnt down. It was kind of hard to pretty much picture that many people living in one place. So they had to really speculate how they layer these houses and how they layer these areas where people lived. So next, this is a discussion question I have. This map you see in chapter 1 of your book, I blew it up a little bit, but if you guys would like in more details, you can see every word in your textbook, in your novel. So one of the questions to consider based on this map is, what would you assume was a preferred method for communication and travel of goods, people, and information? Based on this map, what would you guys think? If you can't read it that well, this is Western Lake. It's a river. Yes.
Boats.
Exactly. Waterways. So they actually did use. This is a large system of canals, and that's one of the reasons why it's drawn into Padua and Venice as its comparison that Marco Polo and other travelers made. But it had. This is why it also stayed as such a prosperous area as well, because of the canals. And all this is a very easy way to actually transport goods, ideas, people. It was, and they also used it as leisure as well. So the communications and supplies. As Marco Polo observed, the city is situated in such a way that it has, on the one side, a lake of fresh water, which is very clear, and on the other side, an enormous river. And then they also, on the map, you can tell that they have a lot of systems of canals that were constructed and were perfected during this time while it was capital. And Marco Polo continues that the streets and canals are so wide and spacious that carts on one and the boats on the other can easily come and go to transport the provisions required for by the inhabitants. So it showed how they really did get supplies from one area to the other. Even though it's so densely populated, these canals were pretty much their main way of getting goods to certain areas of the city. And then also, with the intricate system of canals, it had a comparison of Padua and Venice. Padua is a little bit more inland in northern Italy, but it's probably an hour away from Veneto and Venice. So both were very popular trading areas, so Marco Polo made the comparison many times. And then the amenities of urban life. There are three basic categories that we found in this section. One is restaurants, one is entertainment, and then Cesar is going to talk about the lake in a couple minutes. But the restaurants, the town boasted a multitude of restaurants, hotels, taverns, and tea houses. And this could be explained just because of the dense population and because of the leisure time and the fact that this actual city kept on rising in population and also the economy was growing. So they had more, just pretty much free money to spend. The restaurants and taverns especially had beautiful entry doors. So if you take a look through chapter 1, it discusses just little things with pretty flowers, all things decorating these doors just to encourage people to come in. It was just a very beautiful appearance, especially since some of them were on the lake and or by the river. And one of the other things that ties into the restaurants is the entertainment, and the entertainment at the time included poetry, gardening, and other just social gatherings. But a lot of times this came with class distinctions. So it is pretty well known that a lot of the upper tier people in society would go to certain tea houses in the mornings or just for like a cup of tea later on at night with friends. And so the social class standing really did determine how much leisure time you had and where you would go in these cities.
Alrighty, so the lake is actually a very like big key important thing in the city. It was actually man-made. Well, part of it was they kind of like channeled all the rivers and streams towards the lake eventually to make it into like as big as it is now today. It was actually probably used as one of their like majority of like sources of entertainment. There was like different boats of all kinds spread throughout the city. Majority of people had stakes in these boats or like had their own boat or would use like go out on the lake as like a sort of leisure and entertainment. There was also these famous gardens all along the edges of the lake. So it was like beautiful places for people to go to and kind of a source of entertainment for them to like actually take full advantage of the opportunities they had. And it wasn't just the lake too, the river was also on the other side, which they used like they interchanged. And it was actually, it seemed like a very big aspect of their life and had a lot to do with their economy too as well. And there's a quote from Marco Polo in the book that talks about the lake, and it says, "On the lake of which we have spoken, there are numbers of boats and barges of all sizes for parties of pleasure. They hold 10, 15, 20 or more persons, and from 15 to 20 paces in length with a flat bottom." So you can kind of picture these like really big boats that were just like made to hang out on a subtle lake and have like hangouts and whatnot. And he closes out the quote saying that truly a trip on the lake is a much more charming recreation than can be enjoyed on land. So it kind of like emphasizes the whole idea that this lake wasn't just there as like a body of water. It was this form of like entertainment for the people in the city.
Okay, so moving on, that pretty much covers what was shown in Chapter 1, but moving on to present day, starting with 13th to the 19th century in Hangzhou, it still becomes one of the most popular centers for trade in China. These canals withstand so much time, and they're still well kept up. But during the Ming Dynasty in the 15th century, China began to a period of isolationism, and this hurt the booming city life because there was less foreigners coming into the city, there's less just money pouring into it. And then the port towns were one of the main reasons for this dynasty, as well as some afterwards, for having this feeling of isolationism, was the worry of pirates who were sailing on the coast of China, Japan, and Korea. They were Japanese of descent, and they were traveling all over there, so they tried to like just pretty much limit the amount of attacks that were made on China. And then moving on to the 20th century.
As you can see, the population dropped a good amount. During the whole isolationism, it was about 150,000 people living in the city at the time in 1911 when they did their census. And also following that, in 1911, there was an uprising. It was pretty much the end of like the imperialism in China. It was a sort of movement that went on up until about 1937 when the Japanese came in at the beginning of World War II. And it was occupied up until 1949. It was occupied until Japan fell, but in 1949, the Chinese People's Liberation Army took Hangzhou, and from then on it had been a communist city. And it didn't really affect the economy too much, but it was still became like one of the only like open free ports in China at the time. And as you can see here in 1972, Richard Nixon, who is the first American president to ever visit the city of China, or visit the country of China, goes to Hangzhou. As you can see, there's kind of like the typical Chinese architecture that you would see there. It's kind of like a symbol of China and whatnot, and it was kind of a big thing that he went to the city. And finishing off with the population in 1990, you can see how much it grown to like 1.2 million people.
And then this is just a picture of modern day city. You can see that still the waterways are important to them. There's gardens alongside, and the city is obviously prosperous, doing well. And then finally, so city life in China is still very alive and remains a center, especially for the arts, entertainment, and luxury. City life is also where much of the commercial life occurs. In Hangzhou specifically, the population continues to rise, and the latest census shows 2.5 million people inhabiting the city, as comparison to the modern-day capital of Beijing that has a population. $1 billion. And then finally, the transportation systems have continued to improve, while the canals and roadways from this 13th century and prior are still very